Okay, ladies and gentlemen, why don't we get started? We're actually, looks like about 49 seconds behind schedule, so I will try to speak faster to make up for that time. What a rowdy group we have today. Let's get started. Okay, so the... this is a joke that... I'll edit out the first couple of minutes. It's easy to edit at the beginning and the end. Okay. Tonight's joke, I have not run it past my joke censor board yet, so I may regret this, but I will tell you that I told the joke over to two of my daughters. Aliza's one of them, and neither of them could remember that joke. So that's a good sign. It means that chances are you will not remember it too. The problem is that they both said it wasn't very funny. So I'm going to tell you a joke you may never have heard before, but it's not very funny. So tonight's class is going to deal with prayer. And so this joke, it has to do with Jewish prayer. I'm sure that my censor board has heard this joke anyways, but here it goes. So the joke is about the first three clergymen in outer space, a priest, a rabbi, and a minister. And believe it or not, this is not an off-color joke. I know a lot of those jokes start that way with a priest, a rabbi, and a minister, but it's not one of those jokes. So the priest, the rabbi, and the minister, NASA sponsors this metaphysical tour of the universe where they're going to put these three carefully selected theologians onto the space shuttle, and they go up into outer space and they orbit the world a few times, and that's the program. And I forgot to mention one thing which should be obvious to everyone in this room, but for the internet audience, particularly my seven people watching in Saudi Arabia, just to give you a sense of Jewish prayer. Jewish prayer is relegated basically by times of the day and the position of the sun to the horizon. In the morning, there is the shacharit or dawn prayer. In afternoon, there's the mincha prayer. And then after the sun is set, there is, of course, the ma'ariv prayer, ma'ariv. So the joke goes that the three clergymen go out into outer space. They orbit the world a few times. They come back down. When they land, the journalists crowd around them, and they come out of the space shuttle, and they're transformed. Their faces are glowing from the experience. And they go up to the Catholic priest, and they said, Father, what was your impression of your experience? And he said, well, I was overwhelmed with the hugeness, the vastness of God's creation. Absolutely astounded by the phenomenal infinitude of the universe. And then they go to the minister and they said, Reverend, what did you think of your experience? He says, in the scope of such largeness, I thought of the tininess of humanity. I thought of how humble we are in terms of the great cosmos of God's creation. And they go up to the rabbi and they say, Rabbi, what did you think? And he says, who had time to think? Shachris, mincha marav. Shachris, mincha marav. Okay. Yeah, it's not cute. I think it's I guess, chetzi chetzi. Okay, so tonight's topic is a fascinating one. I've wanted to speak about this topic for a long time, and I'm very grateful to have an audience who's interested in sharing this aspect of Jewish history. We're going to look at a not very well-known figure in history. I believe this is the first video on the internet about this figure, and that makes me feel very proud. Her name is Sarah Bas Tovim, or probably that was pronounced in her time, Soira Bas Tovim, right, from the Yiddish pronunciation. She is an unknown author of tekhines, which are basically Jewish prayers for women, a largely lost aspect of Jewish history that we'll explore over the course of the next half hour, 45 minutes. And it says so much about what has been lost since the Holocaust, because it speaks to the depth of Jewish spirituality and an entire range of spirituality that has been flattened and disappeared with the loss of so many millions in Eastern Europe in particular. So that's going to be our topic for tonight. We have an anonymous sponsor, so I'd like to thank that sponsor. It is wonderful to have all of you here. Your presence is sufficient sponsorship, but if you would like to help support the shul and help support our students who graciously film the video and greet you at the door, then sponsorships are wonderful. Young Israel is setting up an internet sponsorship thing where you can actually, if you're on the internet, you can click on the website and there'll be a little donate button and away you go. So we thank you very much, anonymous sponsor. Okay, so let's start. Who was this Sara Bas Tovim? We know remarkably little about her life, and in fact, just about everything we know is what she tells us. But it's more complicated even than that, because many figures, literary, historical, and otherwise, have interfered with the literary record and have intervened to add details that has made her so legendary in scope that, in fact, many people believe she didn't exist. Although, as we shall see, scholarship today has proved without much doubt that, in fact, she was a woman living in Ukraine in the probably 18th century. She tells her audience that she is descended from Jews in Poland, Brest-Litovsk in particular, or Brisk, and Satanov, although there's some questions as to exactly what her lineage is. We don't know very much beyond what exactly she puts on paper for us to read. And one of the most problematic aspects of her biography is the fact that, you know, because she wrote these basic liturgical poems in the 18th century, they became wildly popular, so popular that all kinds of other people started writing them themselves and placing them in her name so that they could get the royalties. So in other words, it's like, for example, many of you may not realize it, but I often write under the name Stephen King. Oh, yeah. My next Stephen King novel you buy on the internet could actually be one of my novels. But it's just a way of kind of glomming on to that literary reputation, and this happened so frequently that there were these travesties and plagiarisms and outright forgeries that people began to believe in the 19th century that she was probably not a historical figure, and in fact she was an invention of some man. We know now that she was a real person. She was in fact a woman, and we know a lot more about her, thanks to the research of one scholar in particular that I'll introduce you to in a moment. Part of this cynicism about Sara Bas Tovim was generated by the maskilim, which is a larger phenomenon that I'd like to speak about later on in this class, not tonight so much, but in a later class. Maskilim are adherents of the Jewish Enlightenment, known as the Haskalah. This is a movement that began in the very late 18th century in Germany, and it spread throughout Europe. Towards Western Europe, it became more of an assimilationist movement, where the Haskalah placed a lot of emphasis on the value of Jews imitating non-Jews, sometimes slavishly aping non-Jewish norms in an attempt to gain acceptance and to gain emancipation, political emancipation. In Eastern Europe, it took a very different kind of coloring. The Haskalah there did not, for the most part, aspire to assimilate to Russian or Polish or Ukrainian society per se. They rather, the Maskilim in Eastern Europe, tried to excavate a new literary Jewish personality by taking many of the vernacular art forms, such as, for example, Yiddish literature, and elevating it really to a world language. So in the East, you'll have people like Mendel Macher Sforim, Shalom Aleichem, Yud Lamed Peretz, who actually wrote a story about Sara Bas Tovim, who will be, you know, trying to take this traditional folk culture, which has a very deep religious vein running through it, and then transforming it into a more secular, Yiddishized, or in Zionist case, more Hebraicized version. So what was happening with the Jewish population in the late 19th century is a lot of maskilim were writing prayers for women, typically illiterate women who could only make their wares in Yiddish, and we'll have some time to speak about Yiddish tonight, and then they were selling them. And one of the ways to make them popular was to say, these are real tekhines written by Sara Bas Tovim, when in fact they were written by some apikoros non-believer male poet in living in St. Petersburg in 1870. So it's very difficult to unpack what exactly is hers, what exactly are later accretions, but we do have two collections in particular that we know are definitely hers. The texts are very corrupt, and there are many different editions where publishers have done a lot of damage to the text, but nevertheless, tonight we're going to look at those two collections and two tekhines in particular to try to understand a little bit more about her. Now, I should really pause and ask, how many of you are familiar with this liturgical form called the tekhina? And it's not at all associated, by the way, with hummus or pita. I just don't pronounce it very well, but tekhina. Okay, we see a couple of women who have actually read tekhines. So can you tell us anything about them?
I can only tell you that my mother brought from Germany, and it was like so precious to her and her sister and then the other sister-in-law. This was like, this is what they read it all the time.
It was a Kodesh Kodoshim.
German.
Yes, okay.
So it may have been one of the fake guys.
Could be. Was it written in German letters or in Yiddish Deutsch, like in real in German? Okay, I have one of those too from my grandmother, my great aunt from Königsberg, my Aunt Molly.
Was it really?
I'd have to look at it to give you, and I'm not an expert in this field, but I'd have to look at it to give any sense of it. Yes.
How does that relate to the Tzenarena?
Oh, I'm glad you asked that question. The Tzenarena, it was actually something authored by a man, but it formed the basis of what would have ultimately become a very large religious literature for women. The Tzenarena, which is a Yiddish pronunciation of the of a passage in Kohelet, if I remember correctly, go out and see, and it's written in the feminine imperative. And it's basically a weekly commentary on the Chumash, written in Yiddish, that is essentially kind of like a mishmash of Rashi, taking all the midrashim and things like that. So when you read the Chumash, when you know whatever the sedra is that week, if it's this week we're up to a mishpatim, a woman would on Saturday afternoon, she'd pull out her tzenarena and she would read all the midrashim, all of the stories that associate with the Chumash that week. And very pious and often very educated women would treat the Tzenarena as literally as a Bible. It would be a very holy work with them, and it was associated almost exclusively with women. It's interesting that it was translated into English by Art Scroll, and when they released it the first time, they didn't think anyone would want it under its original title, so they released it as the Weekly Midrash, because that's essentially what it is. It's a compilation of Midrashim. And then when people said, oh, this is actually the Tzenarena, so then they re-released it under the title Tzenarena, because they realized that so many women had that ancestral memory of that particular book.
But are they, in fact, in the same time as
the Chumash? Yes. Well, the Tzenarena is a little earlier. We don't know with precision when Sarah Bas Tovim lived, probably 18th century. The Tzenarena goes back another century or two. It's quite an old book. Now, the difference, though, between these two books, the Tzenarena is a book for study, which is, of course, of religious value in Judaism. The tekhines is a work of prayer. Tekhines are liturgical poems, prayer poems that a person reads at various moments in their life, at various moments of their day, and so on.
All right. How does that relate to Tehillim?
Tehillim, also read in a liturgical manner, but that goes back, obviously, to the biblical period.
I don't remember.
Yeah, it goes all the way back to the biblical period, and they're written in Hebrew. So, but what's really fascinating about these tekhines is that they are specifically women's prayers, and they say so much about women's culture, one of the rare glimpses that we have into how women lived in 18th, 19th century that we don't have in male sources. And I hope to expose you to a couple of those aspects of women's culture, which are, to my mind, absolutely fascinating. So, what do we know about her? She says a few interesting autobiographical tidbits. She refers, for example, to her illustrious parents. We're not exactly sure who her illustrious parents are. She says, for example, Mordechai of Satanov, and that particular Mordechai may be associated with another author of various religious works, but we're not precisely sure. The early publishers, some of the earliest editions, though, after her name, they add the suffix, I'm sorry, that you often see, shetichyeh, that she should live, which is normally written after a woman's name. You say her name, that she should live, and that implies she's definitely a real person, because you wouldn't say that about a fictional person. It's kind of like when you see a lot of rabbis, at the end of their name, they have the acronym Shlita. And you know, if you're new to this, you might say, like, what are all these guys? How many Rabbi Shlitas are there? Like, thousands of them. Okay, that was a little too inside joke. But at any rate, these are like indications that she was a real person. And also fascinating, there's no reference anywhere in her works to her husband. There's no reason to assume that she was not married. You know, a lot of her prayers deal with you know, the welfare of children, the welfare of a husband. But she, even though she'll talk about herself, she'll talk about her background, she'll talk about her own experiences, she never says anything about her husband, which is also a highly unusual feature of the authors of tekhines. And that's another, ironically, a stamp of authority, that if it was a fabricated Sarah Bas Tovim, they would have made up. Of course she's married to an incredibly wealthy, good-looking, intelligent man, because that's part of the legend. But the actual tekhines of Sarah Bas Tovim had no reference whatsoever to her husband. So we don't know a lot about her beyond what she decides to tell us herself. Now, the main reason we know so much about her today is undoubtedly due to the very detailed and powerful scholarship of this woman, Professor Chava Weisler, who wrote quite a bit of work about Sarah Bas Tovim and other women who composed prayers in early modern Eastern Europe. And in particular, we're going to be relying on this book, Voices of the Matriarchs, which was nominated for the Jewish Book Award a few years ago. Unfortunately, I did not have the opportunity to reread it for this class. I read it when it first came out, and I loved it, but I couldn't get another copy of it back down here in Florida through ILL. But I will be reading from one of her articles that she wrote on this particular woman. At any rate, I highly recommend Voices of the Matriarchs, which will tell you a lot about tekhines as an art form, Sarah Bas Tovim in particular, and so on. So let's get down to the material itself. First of all, it's written in Yiddish, which is in itself an entire history of Jewish culture. The Yiddish language is basically medieval German, written in Hebrew characters with a very strong infusion of Hebrew, Aramaic, Romance, and Slavic words. The comedian Billy Crystal says that the way you understand this is that Yiddish is basically German with phlegm. Right? Okay. Pause for laughs. But in reality, it's essentially medieval German with all these other languages written in. Now, this is not an unusual phenomenon. Jews have created many hybrid languages over the last 2,000 years. Whenever they go to a given locale, they invariably pick up a lot of the language, the vocabulary, the syntax, and then they, because quite often the surrounding populations are illiterate, then Jews will use the Hebrew alphabet to record the language. And that, you know, creates this new kind of hybrid language. So we have Judeo-Persian, we have Judeo-German, which is a little bit different form of Yiddish. We have several different versions of Yiddish to come to speak of. And they often show high varieties of dialectical variation. So, for example, in Eastern Europe, there's at least three distinct dialects of Yiddish. The Lithuanians were really the first to truly standardize the language and kind of agree on spelling, for example, very basic issues like morphology. And so standard Lithuanian Yiddish is considered the, well, the gold standard in the culture. This is somewhat resented by Hungarian Jews and by Polish Jews, but for those Lithuanian Jews, of course, they're absolutely correct. This is the true Yiddish. And you may know some Lithuanians. They tend to have, you know, the very fine intellects, very, you know, fashionable taste in clothing. Latvia as well, right? They tend to lose their hair prematurely, and hopefully you're getting the joke. Oh, I happen to be Lithuanian. Yes, I am. Thank you, Stephen. My timing is off tonight. But at any rate, there are lots of different pronunciations. It is a crazy language. Even 100 years ago, Yiddish was not standardized, and you can see huge variations in spellings of words and so on. It is a language that is very prone to interpolation from other languages. It's more infected by languages, and that's a perfectly okay thing to do. Unlike, for example, the French, who are, you know, really paranoid about keeping on to their language, that they have actually a commission in the government that decides what word is French and what word can't be French. And even in Israel, they had that for a long time with Hebrew, that, you know, they wouldn't allow words that were not of Hebrew origin. Yiddish was just like the doors were wide open. You could say anything you want. I was just reading something written in the 1950s in Yiddish the other day, and I was having a really hard time working through movies like words like baseball, right? Baseball, and movie, which was also in there. That was a really hard one. But actually, there was one. I'm curious if anyone knows this. This is a little bit of a tangent. There was a reference to someone called a Sam Sapozhnik. Yeah, does anyone know what that expression means? I had to ask a very old man, what does it mean? Erist a Sam Sapozhnik. So apparently a Sam Sapozhnik is, he defined it first in Yiddish as Alaina Balabas, and which is means he's like independent to a fault, like he thinks he knows everything. And the context was about someone who refuses to listen to doctors, doesn't want to take the medicine he's prescribed. Sam Sapozhnik, right? He does whatever he wants. Yeah, so there are such people. I'm not sure, but the word sam might come from the Russian, which means self. Like samovar means to self-cook, right? Things like that. So sam might be alone, and Sapozhnik, I don't know what that is. Anyways, I'm sorry for that digression. Sam is in Hebrew poison, right? But in Hebrew, but in Russian, sam it means samolot, for example, means flies by itself or an airplane. Now, why are we talking about Yiddish so much? Because the Jews in Eastern Europe spoke Yiddish overwhelmingly as their vernacular. At the end of the 19th century, the Russian government did a survey, a massive survey that gives us a good picture of what Jews did in that part of the world, and 97% of Jews claimed Yiddish as their mother tongue, which is amazing when you think it's only just a little over 100 years ago that that was the overwhelming vernacular, and we've lost so much in just one century. Other languages, Russian, French, German, and so on, made very, very little penetration into the Jewish world. However, Yiddish was not the educated language, with the exception of the Maskilim, who wanted to elevate it to an art form, like Shalom Aleichem and others. The reality is that it was considered not a real language, even by those who spoke it. You know, my grandmother, Aleha Shalom, when she used to talk about the language, she wouldn't even say Yiddish. That wasn't a name. She called it Jewish, which is exactly what the word Yiddish means, Jewish. This is the Jewish language, meaning, I don't know what you call it, it's Jewish. And a lot of literature of the time called it the jargon, right, the jargon. It wasn't considered a real language, even by the practitioners of the language itself. What was the real language, of course, was rabbinic Hebrew. If you wanted to write a letter that had chashivut, that if you wanted to demonstrate your education, you had to do it in Hebrew. And that was also a highly gendered language, because the threshold for learning Hebrew at a high level definitely stopped at about fourth grade level for girls. It was very rare to have a woman who could read Hebrew and translate it beyond basically the Siddur, the prayers that she had memorized, perhaps some Tehillah, perhaps some Chumash, but certainly not into the rabbinic works of scholarship on the Talmud and things like that. So Yiddish was also known as the Weibische Sprach, the woman's language, because it was the language of literature for women. Now, Jewish women were also quite educated when you compare them to the surrounding culture, and their literacy would consist of being able to decipher the written word. They could not do it in Hebrew, but they could do it in Yiddish. And so this created a demand in the 16th century and onwards for works in Yiddish for women. That's where the Tzinarena came about, and then slowly people started writing various kinds of like pietistic works for women that were designed to like be uplifting of good morals and things like that. It got to be quite a large genre, and it was not only women that read this. It was considered to be sort of like a low-class literature for men. If you look at, for example, the works of the great Chafetz Chaim writing around the turn of the 20th century, he urges Jews in America, saying, I know you guys are not very educated and you probably can't read too much, but at least read something in Yiddish. Go and get a Yiddish book on ethics, on Musar, things like that. So Yiddish was highly gendered. It was considered a lower class language, but it was considered the language that women used. And so these prayers that people like Sarah Bas Tovim are written specifically for that gender, and in a way that speaks to a woman's experience in the world, something which we have completely lost in the Holocaust. Now, we should also note that even though they were written in Yiddish, Sarah Bas Tovim and the other liturgical writers had no problem ripping off things from earlier rabbinic literature. And this is because, as I think we discussed in an earlier class, the concept of plagiarism as we have it today was not really understood, or I shouldn't say that, was not really observed by earlier authors. It was considered appropriate to steal really, you know, cool phrases and even whole paragraphs from earlier writers and incorporate them into your own work. We call it plagiarism. Back then they would call it something like homage, right? It was kind of like a way of showing honor to those earlier writers, and that was considered entirely appropriate. Sarah Bas Tovim, in her work, she refers to herself in a very humble way as saying she's simply arrange the tekhines, meaning that she's cutting and pasting. She's taking a line from here and a few stanzas from here, and he's putting them in poems, so she doesn't want to take too much credit for herself. But at the same time, she also asserts that these are her creations, even though they are collages of early literary works, and she very much identifies them as her own, the product of her own creative energies, and she's very proud of them, as we shall see as I read you a few samples. In terms of how educated she was, it's quite likely that she was deeply educated. She certainly quotes liberally from Hebrew texts, so she must have been one of those exceptional women who did kind of break that fourth grade glass ceiling to be able to get entree into rabbinic scholarship. She's clearly familiar with a lot of the ethical literature, like Shaarei Tshuva of Rabbeinu Yonah, like the Orchos Tzadikim by an anonymous author who, incidentally, this was also written in Yiddish and also could have been written, according to some, possibly even by a woman. So she's reading these kinds of texts. She knows how to put them in proper rabbinic context. And as we shall see, she even has a smattering of Kabbalistic knowledge. Chava Weisler has also identified some of the influence of Shabbatai Tzvi in her works. Not that she followed down the path of false messianism, but some of the earlier works of his followers actually had quite a large penetration into the reading public of Jews in the 18th century. So it's not surprising that she would have found some of that interesting as well. So we must assume that she does have some kind of formal Jewish education. Okay, before I talk about the first of her works, any other questions? Quickly, Ms. Abramson, no questions?
Let me think.
Let me think. I'll give you lots of time. Okay, so let's go straight into it. We have two basic collections of her works that are considered authoritative by Professor Weisler. The first is called Shar HaYichud Al Olamot, or Olamos, which is a very Kabbalistic term, meaning the gate of the uniting of the worlds. And this refers to a very deep Kabbalistic concept that we discussed it a few weeks ago when we talked about the Arizal, the idea that there are four worlds, Atzilut, Bria, Yetzira, and Asiya, four sort of concentric worlds of Kabbalah, and that they have to be kind of lined up. Alternatively, the ten sfirot, you see in the drawing here, the ten sfirot, the emanations of God, can kind of go out of alignment as a result of human sin. And so there are various practices, you know, religious practices, prayer practices that can kind of bring them back into alignment. Definitely very esoteric, not standard kind of thinking. This particular book is often known by one of the major poems that is recorded in it, which is more feminine in its aspect, Sheker Hachein, which means beauty is deceitful. You may recognize the line from Eshet Chayil, right? Sheker Hachein, Behevel HaYofi, Isha Yirat Hashem, Hiti Talal. Is that right? Did I get right? Hiti Talal, right? Beauty is vain, Sheker Hachein, Behevel, and good looks are empty. A woman who fears God, she will be praised. So the phrase Sheker Achein has a very strong allusion to women's values, the idea of what should a woman be praised for. Obviously a woman who fears God, not to pay attention to external beauty and so on. And the kind of themes that emerge from her writing are basically three. And I'm just, you know, I'm performing homage right now to Professor Weisler, ripping off her three basic ideas. First of all, it's a very strong emphasis in women as religious agents, meaning women count in Judaism. There's not a question that, despite the fact that women have a highly distinct religious experience from men, meaning they are not showing up in shul typically early in the morning for Shacharis and then Mincha and then Maariv, and they don't have the special costumes that the men do, and they don't have the multiple hoo-has. By the way, my wife likes to call this room like the guys' club, the men's club, you know, because not on Shabbos, but during the week, this is the guys' club. There are very, very few women who come during the week to Mincha, Maariv, things like that. But there are some, but it's comparatively rare. Nevertheless, despite the fact that men and women had a bifurcated religious experience, she has no problem completely affirming the idea that women are religiously significant and that their actions count on the most metaphysical of levels. Secondly, this is not in any way meant to contradict the value of women as wives and mothers. That in fact, much of this religious agency is fulfilled through what might be the very mundane acts of caring for a family. And these things form, you know, moments of prayer that show up nowhere in men's liturgy. For example, in this entire realm of feminine prayer, you'll find all kinds of tekhines written for things like, you know, on menopause, for example. You know, I haven't seen that in any of the men's prayer books. On caring for a child who is ill, on praying for a child to find a match, all kinds of life cycle things that are much more associated with women, these are things that you'll find in the tekhines. And so it's an entirely different world of prayers than the ones which men which will recite that are far more ritualistic and rote in nature, tend to be very, you know, reified in their format and very fixed in their language. The tekhines are much more free-flowing, much more individualistic, much more poetic in nature. She spends a lot of time talking about suffering, and there's some interesting kind of clues as to what exactly it was that she was suffering about so much. And finally, a great affirmation throughout her work of her own personal value, her feeling that even though she is suffering, she feels that what she is doing is of benefit to the world and that will ultimately bring about the coming of the Messiah. Very strong belief that her actions count on a metaphysical level. There's no question that nowhere in her tekhines does it ever appear that she feels that she's only in a supporting role, that men are in the starring reel. She really feels very strongly like, okay, this is men's Judaism, so to speak, this is women's Judaism, and women's Judaism is great. There's no question whatsoever about status. Okay, so the second work that's really important is known as the Shlosh HaShaarim, and it's probably better known than the Sheker Achein, the Three Gates. The earliest version that we have that has a date on it is 1838, but there are many editions published far earlier that means that it probably dated from the late 18th century. It's more popular than the earlier work and tends to be more ripped off and more interpolated with different things since then. So I think at this point, why don't I read you a little bit of the tekhines so you can get a sense of, you know, what is it exactly that we're talking about. This is an article that Professor wrote in a series called Poland, which is about Jews of Poland. Okay, so this is from the first collection that I mentioned to you, the Sheker Achein. Oh, dear women and maids, and maids meaning like young women, if you read this tekhina, your hearts will rejoice. They are taken out of holy books, meaning that she's gone to the sources and she's going, what gives them value is their authenticity in the tradition. By their merit, you will be worthy to enter the land of Israel. So there's a very early proto-Zionism here as well. Also, I have put down a lovely new tekhina that should be said on Mondays and Thursdays and fast days and on the days of awe. Grace is deceitful and beauty is vain. Definitely interesting that Mondays and Thursdays, of course, being Torah reading days, and she's very much clued into the fast day cycle, things like that. Beauty is nothing, only righteous deeds are good. The wisest of women builds her house. The important thing that a woman should run the house so that one can study Torah therein, and that she should guide her children in the straight path to God's service. Note that it doesn't say that she should run her house so that men can study Torah therein, meaning that the house should be a place where anyone can study Torah, men or woman, man or son, you know, children, so on. I, poor woman, have been scattered and dispersed. I have had no rest. My heart has moaned within me. I recalled from whence I come and whither I shall go and where I shall be taken. A great fear came over me, and I begged the living God, blessed be He, with copious tears, that the tekhina might come out of me. So here's an allusion to something we'll discuss in the next slide. She's somehow in some kind of state of wandering that gives her great suffering. And out of this suffering, she will produce the religious energy that will be expressed in her poetry. And now she says a little bit about who she is. I, the renowned woman Sarah Bas Tovim, she has no problem saying, you know, she's renowned, of distinguished ancestry, who has no strange thought. Wow. The Hebrew here is machshava zara, which means like a machshava zara really means like a foreign thought. It can be a thought of violence, a thought of illicit sexuality, you know, thoughts that are inappropriate really for a person of high religious. And it's interesting that she can say this about herself, that she does not have a machshava zara, which is more of a Kabbalistic term, but has made this tekhina only for the sake of the dear God, blessed be He, so that it may be a memorial for me after my death. I think the meaning here is that in composing this tekhina, she was doing it for nothing other than the love of God. I mean, it was not thinking of her own fame or her own wealth, that kind of thing. Whoever reads this tekhina, her prayer will certainly be accepted before God. May His name be blessed. I, the woman Sarah Bas Tovim, daughter of the scholar, learned Torah, the renowned Rabbi Mordechai, son of the great luminary Rabbi Yitzchak, of blessed memory, of the holy community of Satanov, may God protect it. So, very interesting kind of overlapping of themes there. You get a sense of her personality. She has a real sense of self, no problem whatsoever about this. Now, let me read just a little bit more from a different selection in the Three Gates. I take for my help the living God, blessed be He, who lives forever and to eternity, and I set out this second beautiful new tekhina in Yiddish with great love, with great awe, with trembling and terror, with broken limbs, with great petition. May God have mercy upon me and upon all Israel. May I not long be forced to be a wanderer, once again the wandering, by the merit of our mothers Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah, and may my own dear mother, Leah, pray to God, blessed be He, for me, that my being a wanderer may be an atonement for me for my sins. May God, blessed be He, forgive me for having talked in synagogue in my youth during the reading of the dear Torah. Talking in shul is going to be one of her big themes. I'm going to read you something about that in a second. Lord of the whole world, I lay my prayer before you. As I begin to edit my second lovely new tekhina with my entire devotion and with the entire foundation of my heart, may you protect us from suffering and pain. I pray the dear Lord, blessed be He, that just as He heard the prayer of our fathers and mothers, He may soon have great mercy on all Israel and also on the years of my old age, that I not be forced to wander. And I beg heaven and earth and all the holy angels to pray for me, that both of my tekhinas may be accepted. May they be a crown for His holy name upon His head. Amen. So, was tutzach with the wandering? Let's try and understand that a little bit. Oh, I'm going to go here to this slide first. So, what is this kind of wandering that she keeps referring to? She doesn't say anywhere why she wanders, but Elisa is going to offer a suggestion. You're not supposed to read my slide before I say it, but go ahead, read it.
Go.
Not galus, right. She does not use the term galus. She uses the term in Hebrew, navanad. Now, why would those terms be said? Why would my brilliant daughter say, well, of course, she's talking about galus. Why would you even think galus?
Because that means that we're not in our homeland and therefore we're wandering in other places, we're in the diaspora.
Oh my gosh, this is the future of our people. Do you see this? My gosh, you're absolutely right, Aliza. She's so brilliant. She said, she refers to the fact that the word galus or galut in modern Hebrew means exile, but as a term, it basically means being kicked out of the land of Israel. Meaning the exile from the first century when the Romans took over Israel, cleared out all the Chinese restaurants, the Jews left immediately. Oh, that's a joke. I should edit that out. It's not very tasteful. But at any rate, that kind of terminology, it's almost like it's a throwaway term. We're living in Gaulis. We're living in exile. Yeah. We're living in exile. Maybe we'll go to Israel for the holidays. We'll come back. That's the idea of Gaulis. And so therefore, if she used this term Gaulis, then maybe she's speaking metaphorically. She's living in a nice big house in Eastern Europe someplace with chandeliers, plastic on the furniture, and she calls it Gaulis. That would make sense. But she doesn't use that term. She uses the term Navanad. What does Navanad mean?
Cain.
Like Cain, very good. Oh my gosh, Steve, what an educated audience. I have to really up my game, right? That Cain is cursed to wander, Navanad, to go throughout the land. That's a real, she means it in a real sense. She's physically actually moving from place to place. It is something that causes her great suffering, and she hopes that that suffering will elicit tshuva, will elicit, you know, a return to her religious roots. There is a lot there's a huge tradition in Rabbinic Judaism of self-imposed penitential wandering, where people will go into exile as an attempt to change their mazal, as an attempt to change their own personal makeup, because when you move to a new place, people don't know you, they don't necessarily treat you with the same kind of respect that you have when you're in your homeland and so on. Now, this is the only occasion I know of a woman going into galus, into personal navanad, personal wandering. Many of the great rabbis did so, the Vilna Gaon, many of them would, you know, pick up and leave places where they were famous and go to places where they were unknown as a way of working on their own personality. Then they would come back and, you know, it would be better for them and so on. But for a woman to go into galus seems like a much more difficult endeavor, and it seems that may be what she was doing. It could also be read, however, that maybe, you know, it could be much more prosaic, that her husband's business was not successful and they went from town to town trying to make a parnassa, and she interpreted this in a religious light, that they had to go follow the parnassa wherever it was, and she took this as kind of a lever for herself to develop spiritually. But what she attaches it to more than anything else is her own behavior, specifically talking in shul. So let's look at one phrase where she refers to that, and she's very generous with this kind of personal biographical detail. Here we go. She says, she's talking about how she used to talk in shul all the time, and she says, I wish the rabbi were here to hear this. He would love this part. But I have to get one for the men talking in shul, which is an even bigger problem, I think. I remember all the things I used to do when I used to come into the Deer Synagogue, all dressed up in jewelry, which Professor Weisler points out probably gives us some kind of socioeconomic locator for her. If she's all dressed up in jewelry, perhaps upper middle class, something like that. I would do nothing but joke and laugh. Today I remember and recall that God, blessed be He, does not forgive, as it is written, He who is quick to anger and extends His wrath. He waits long and pays quickly. Which is a kind of uncharitable view, I think, of, you know, but today I go wandering and my heart moans within me, for I recall that God, blessed be He, will forgive no one. Again, very strong kind of language, which is, I'm not too comfortable with myself, but here it is. Therefore, I entreat you to listen to my words and take them to heart. When you enter the Deer Synagogue, a great terror should overcome you. I have jokes in my head now. You should know before whom you have come and to whom you pray and to whom you must answer for your life. So definitely a very stark kind of Musardic view of taking shul seriously. It's not a playground, it's not a gossip center, it's a place where you stand before the Ribono Shel Olam. You know, this is meant to make women tzitter, to make women kind of like take shul very seriously. She's not saying at all that shul is not important. She's saying that go to shul with awe and trepidation. It's interesting now I think about it, the Vilna Gaon, who we mentioned earlier, when he went to, on his own personal exile, he tried to make it to Israel, he wrote a very famous letter to his wife, you know, in case he never came back, in case, you know, he was lost on the journey or killed or whatever, he wrote a last will, as it were, to his wife, giving her direction how he'd like to raise the children. And he says to his wife, don't go to shul. He says clearly, he says, you know, you go to shul and there's only lashon hara and people got, he says to him, don't go to shul. Very interesting passage. Anyways, that gives you a sense of some of her personality, what little we know about her life. A lot of her tekhines, and this is also, you know, I'll give you one example in particular, but I'll give you kind of an overview here. She basically, in the three gates, writes about three different types of things. The first gate deals with the mitzvahs known as chana, an acronym. Obviously, the name of the founder of prayer as we have it today, the prophetess Chana, mother of Shmuel, they stand for the three commandments which are associated primarily with women. The first one, the Chet, stands for, Aliza?
Chana.
No, the Chet of Chana stands for something.
Chesed.
Not Chesed, no. Oh, Aliza, no. What, every Friday? Chalot, exactly, Chala. Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you said Chana, I'm sorry. Chalot, bediyuk. Kazeh, right? Chalot, the challah. There's a particular mitzvah that when you bake challah of a certain size, you have to take a little bit of it. Everybody's guessing letters now. I shouldn't have gone down this direction. But when you bake challah of a certain size, you have to take a little bit of the dough and you have to throw it into the oven. There's a bracha if it's a certain size, so on. So that's specifically associated with women in the kitchen. Nida, the laws of menstruation and sexuality. Of course, women are in control of that aspect of their bodies. And finally, the hay, hadlakat nerot, right? The lighting of candles on Friday nights. So she has all these beautiful prayers that are designed to be said around this cycle. I mean, prayers that are associated with the menstrual cycle, which obviously don't appear in the men's prayer books. Prayers for going to the mikveh, prayers for reuniting with her husband, all kinds of really gorgeous, you know, very personal, immediate, first-person prayers that have no parallel in the Jewish religious tradition. The second gate deals with the entire penitential season of the month of Elul, followed by the holidays of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, a period of personal, you know, introspection and self-transformation. She takes teshuvah very seriously, and she writes quite a few, you know, introspective poems, the meditations for women at that time. And then finally, also something associated with women in our tradition, Rosh Chodesh, the new moon, which is one perhaps of all three. This is perhaps the most well-known in the broader Jewish community as being a woman's holiday, but nothing like the depth and sophistication that we see in Sarah Bas Tovim. Now, what I'd like to do now is to take you to one of these in particular that is perhaps her most famous, and in the last 10 minutes of the class, I'll just give you a glimpse into the sophistication, depth, and beauty of the women's traditions in Eastern Europe that unfortunately have been totally lost in the Holocaust. This is a ritual that is almost unheard of today, even though we have a tradition stretching back all the way to at least the 12th century. That's the first written reference to this particular custom that simply has no place elsewhere in the tradition. It's known as kevermessen, also known as feldmessen, which means grave measuring or grave yard measuring. Feldmessen is like a feld, field is like a graveyard. And the custom basically was that women during the month of Elul, right, during that period of Teshuvah, they would take twine and they would go out to the cemeteries and they would literally measure out the graves. They would take the twine and they would measure it all out around the graves, and then they would come back home with those wicks and they would collectively as a group get together and they would make them into candles. So the wicks were made literally from the outlines of the graves of their ancestors. It would be a business for some women that they would go out and they would measure the entire graveyard and they would sell bits of this string that women would later use. These candles, many of them, I'm sorry?
could that be where the red bendel?
The red bendel comes from, it's actually also a very old tradition, but it's referenced in the Talmud. It's a complicated thing to explain. It's not related to this, though. It just happens to be the same thread. I'll explain it to you after we shut off the camera, if you like. But this is these candles would then be specifically lit on Yom Kippur or used throughout the year. But specifically on Yom Kippur, there would be candles lit for every member of the family, and candles quite often lit for the deceased. We have the Yahrzeit candle, which is kind of like an echo of this custom. But since the Holocaust, this entire thing has been absolutely lost. And it is a way, though, of literally connecting with these long wicks, the living and the dead, bringing the cycle of life, connecting the youngest members of a community with the ancestors who may have lived there for centuries. And I'd like to read you just a little bit from a tekhina that she writes about this particular practice. Okay, when she writes here. Okay, now, so this is referring to after they've gotten all of the wicks together and they've made them into candles, they're going to prepare to light them in memory of those who are deceased and also in for a long life for their husbands and for their children. If you look in, for example, the Mate Ephraim, which is perhaps the most important source on the halachot of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, he refers to this particular practice, and he says, you know, be very careful who you buy the wicks from, because some of these people, they sell the cheapest things that don't burn very well. But even though that's a backhanded reference to the ritual, it's no question that it was extremely widespread in Eastern Europe. May these lights, which were made for the holy and pure souls, awaken them, so that they arise and inform one another back to the holy patriarchs and matriarchs, and further back to Adam and Eve, that they rectify the sin by which they brought death into the whole world. May they arise from their graves and pray for us, that this very year, may it come for good, there may finally be the resurrection of the dead. May God's attributes of stern judgment become the attribute of mercy. May they be unified. This is a very Kabbalistic reference. May the souls pray for us that the resurrection of the dead will come to pass. And may all the holy and pure angels pray that the dry bones live again speedily and soon. So clearly, deeply Kabbalistic intent here that the wicks somehow awaken the souls of the ancestors and somehow bring them into the communal prayer with the living. Lord of the world, I pray you, merciful God, accept the lights that we make for the holy, pure souls. For each wick that we lay, may you increase life for us. May the holy souls awake out of their graves and pray for us that we may be healthy. It is fitting for us to pray for the dead, for those who died in our own generations, and for those who have died from the time of Adam and Eve on. Today we make candles for the sake of all the souls, for the sake of the souls who lie in the fields and the forests, and for all the martyrs, and for all those who have no children, and for all the little children, so that they may awaken the dry bones. May they come alive speedily and soon. May we be worthy to see the resurrection of the dead this year. Amen. Selah. Very powerful, emotive prayer. If you can imagine, you know, actually going to the graves of your own ancestors and knowing that the wick that you're lighting is specifically wrapped around the grave of your, God forbid, your parents and grandparents and so on. It's a very, very beautiful ritual that unfortunately totally lost to us today. So if we look at the legacy of Sarah Bas Tovim, we see with tremendous clarity the great difficulty of, as this is Chava Weisler's phrase, of tracing women's customs in men's sources. Since this was a ritual exclusively associated with women, men did not do it. It was considered an act of female piety. The men didn't write down very much about it. And so therefore, all we have are these few little scraps like Sarah Bas Tovim who've given us some insight into why women did this, what they felt when they did this, and so on. The men may have referenced it like the Mate Ephraim as kind of a backhanded way, but really to get a sense of the inner spiritual life of women in the 18th century, 17th century, we need works of poetry such as those by Bas Tovim. And it also, I hope, illustrates the tremendous impoverishment of specifically Jewish female spirituality that we have suffered as a loss of the huge, you know, disruption, the demographic dislocation that we suffered as a Holocaust, because many of these things that would have been handed down, you know, mother to daughter, were simply cut off with the devastation of the middle of the 20th century. And many of our own daughters today are completely bereft of these traditions, and it's up to scholars like Professor Weisler to bring them back, to re-energize them, and to make them available to us today. My own wife has several collections of modern tekhines, and I looked at a couple of them before coming to our class today. And none of them, you know, although they're very nice books, and you know, she reads them till they fall apart. In a couple of cases, it's actually, I think, the third time I bought her this book, because she keeps on wearing out the binding, and they're tear stained, and that's, I think, probably the way that Santa Arenas used to look back then. But they pale in comparison to some of the religious creativity that has been lost in our own time. So may we have the merit to see these things recreated by people like Aliza and her generation, so we have a much better future for all of us. Thank you for your attention. I'll take questions after we shut off the camera.